Edge Impulse has been acquired by Qualcomm. What does that mean for their existing community and developers? And will an LLM fit inside a microcontroller? To find out if it's possible, I spoke to Serge Maillet. Hi Serge, great to see you here at Embedded World 2025. Now, at the Edge Impulse stand, there's obviously a lot of news to share, especially around the Qualcomm acquisition. But before we go into what that benefits the community and what we can expect to see in the future, let's talk a little bit about the tech first. One of the big things that is sort of changing in the world of creating machine learning models for embedded systems is model cascading. We're used to having models to do to run our AIs and machine learning algorithms. But what's the model cascading all about?
So it's very interesting. We have a couple of demos this year about model cascading. And basically, there's a couple of things happening in the industry. One is that processors and embedded devices are getting more powerful. So you can run more things, and then more operations, things in different MCU, MPU. So model cascading. We have a demo here. It's usually very useful. You basically it consists in running one or more than one models in every device that complement each other. Basically, the cascading is a model run first, and this model can make some suggestions to the next model, right? From filtering, the most usual scenario is you have an object detection model that pre-selects objects that are meaningful to whatever operation, whatever mission you have, and then passes them to a model that perhaps needs more energy or it's requires more compute to run. So instead of running a heavy model all the time, you have a lightweight model that first pre-selects interesting stuff to look at. And that's very useful in terms of embedded software. If you imagine devices in the field that run perhaps on battery, you want to preserve that energy. You don't want to be doing inference all the time or heavy inference all the time. So you want models that first pre-select or activate the device when something interesting is going on. And if something interesting is there, the beefier model kicks in and does the analysis and reports back, etc.
So I can imagine that maybe one of those visual camera doorbells, it first detects if the object there is a human.
Yes.
And then if it is a human, it uses the person detection model to detect, is it a person that I have trained on or a person I know of?
That's a very good example. Yeah, that would be a good one. You can also imagine conveyor belts where you want to make sure that what you're analyzing, let's say a fruit conveyor belt, right? You want to see what apples are healthy and what not, but maybe you have a stones, rocks, other stuff that you're not interested, you still want to know that this is not an apple. So you have the object detection, that's an apple, let's analyze this, let's not analyze the rock. So it has a million applications.
And That was very clever. Now, I think that moves into the world of VLMs, isn't that right? Video language models or visual language models.
Yeah, that's another thing that I just, that we're being able to do that now with devices like the one we have here. Like it is a Qualcomm 9075. It's a very powerful device. And at that point we can start running heavy stuff like VLMs, right? The most impressive stuff in this particular demo, we're running an off-the-shelf Llama-based VLM. So it's not, we haven't optimized it for embedded or anything like this, it's just running, it's powerful enough to do that.
Wow.
And then VLMs change the game quite substantially, or LLMs, if you will.
Yeah.
Because at that point you can do that model cascading, filter out what you're interested in.
Yeah.
And then run your prompts on LLMs, tweak these prompts, and get extra information that perhaps you wouldn't get with a very set model. And you can, it's much easier to modify as you go, right? You just change prompts and keep taking advantage of that.
Now, one of the biggest problems we've talked about in the past with Edge Impulse and other machine learning suppliers and people playing in that area is the acquisition of data. You know, I need that initial data to be able to train the model at all.
Yes.
Now, I understand that you can also use an LLM in the cloud to, you know, maybe label data.
Yeah, we do that, actually. We've been doing that for a bit this year. I'm sure that you've seen Jan's videos. They were very famous. But that's I would still call that model cascading. It's just the models are not necessarily running on device, right? So the idea is you have data, even if you have good amounts of data, you can always enhance that data, the labels to that data with an LLM, such as ChatGPT, right?
Yep.
So the better, everybody knows in ML world, the better the data, the better the model, and the better the performance. So we offer in NetSimples, you have it very well integrated, so you can run extra prompts over your data. Let's say you have a model that detects who's wearing hard hats and who's not in a factory floor, right? And this model, you know, you have different factory floors, people wear different color factory hats, or the factory is different, so you can help the model and ask the LLM extra questions, like, hey, is this that color hat? Or maybe different hats mean different things. So you can always enhance your data and not necessarily retrain your original model, right? You can use a model, an external model, to make the data better.
And of course, in the world media, it's things like ChatGPT and large language models that get a lot of the attention. Did you ever imagine that sort of large language models be something that could be run on a microcontroller type platform?
I figured that will happen someday. I just didn't know it would happen so fast.
Yeah.
I literally remember myself, I think it was a TechX 2 years ago at the booth, and somebody was asking, oh, can we run LLMs on those devices? I'm like, well, not really, see, that's really far away. We don't do that. It's just not worth it. And here we are, one of our demos has a VLM, not only an LLM, but a VLM running. As you might have figured out, this industry is moving very fast, and we have two very fast moving industries. We have embedded industries releasing devices like this, like the Qualcomm 9075 is super beefy, and the AI industry is finding ways to optimize and to run more complex models in more efficient ways, as you can see, like every month in the news, right? So these two things converging makes it so that we can consider different ways to deploy an embedded and to make better models. Yeah.
Now, going through some of the research papers from various congresses on sort of tiny ML models and things like that, they talk about the models that run in the cloud having billions of parameters, and then they sort of, I don't know how they do it, but they seem to shrink them down so they can work on a microcontroller. So how are those big cloud-based LLMs being modified so that they can be used in these less powerful processors?
Right. So, I mean, it's basically what you said, like the amount of the billion of parameters. Usually at NetSimples, the ones that we're using are off the shelf. So some devices are powerful enough to be able to run those. But it's basically about the amount of parameters you have in one of those models. If you reduce it, the model performance will be worse, but you need less of less power to run it, or less processing. And the way I see it now is, we're running, I think, a 3 billion parameter VLM here, if I'm not wrong. We're not necessarily reducing it ourselves, or we're not doing any work on creating our own LLM or reduce. For the demos, we can use the off-the-shelf ones.
Yeah.
You wouldn't be able to run a big cloud one on devices, but again, the current one with 3 billion parameters, with even less billion parameters, we're seeing amazing performance, good enough for some cases, right? So it's not, in devices usually you don't need the nuance and complexity of a cloud LLM like ChatGPT or something like this, but basically you need perhaps simpler things like, oh, what kind of car is this? Is this a van? Is it a car? And then you can lower down the amount of parameters, the size of the model. And
reduce the complexity overall. One of the frustrating elements especially for engineers, I think, when we go and use things like ChatGPT is the number of hallucinations and number of mistakes it makes.
Yes.
Obviously, in an embedded application, ideally, we don't want any mistakes at all. And some of embedded applications are functional safety compliant.
Yeah.
I mean, how can I make sure my model is reliable for the same types of data inputs, I definitely get the correct data response?
That's a very good question. You don't want to, embedded devices are often in critical mission, very sensitive areas. You don't want to rely on a hallucination. I think that there's two answers to that. Well, the first one is up to you. You shouldn't put an LLM on a very critical path where people's lives depend on it. But at the same time, like at NetSimples, one of those demos we have, you can test for it. You can have a certain amount of control and certainty that the model will perform as you expect. The way we do it is we run the same, in that case of this demo, we run the same VLM in the cloud with the same prompts that you're using on the device. And we have a ground truth in which we know what are the actual values we expect. And then we run the VLM on those values and we compare. And it gives you a certain amount of security knowing that the LLM will perform as you expect. Again, I would not recommend anybody to use LLMs directly on making critical life decisions, stuff like this.
Yep.
But it's the way I see it is a very good complement to existing models.
Yep.
In which you get kind of a wild card, just similar to ChatGPT. You can ask them about anything about your model and enhance or make interesting decisions based on what your other models are already yielding.
So. Yeah. Yeah. Now the final question or topic for us is obviously the Qualcomm acquisition that's just been announced.
Big news, yeah.
Yeah, exactly, which is always really exciting. It's, yeah. It's great to see a startup develop a market, build a huge community, and then sort of get recognition in this way.
Yeah.
What is Qualcomm's acquisition of you going to do for Edge Impulse and all its existing customers and users?
Well, it's very exciting. Qualcomm obviously is a big player. It fits very well overall. We're a good fit. We have a very strong developer community. Qualcomm likes that, wants to grow the developer community as well, and I think that we can benefit of each other very well. I think it's exciting. It basically gives us more resources, more access to interesting departments, tooling, obviously hardware that Qualcomm is doing.
Yeah.
What users can expect is Edge Impulse is not going to change their mission or radically change. What we're going to see is more deployment targets, more integrations, on the same Edge Impulse with more resources. We'll be able to do more faster, and we'll keep working with the community, with all the developers, because that's what both Qualcomm and Edge Impulse want. That's our specialty.
It's fascinating to talk to you and find out what's going on in the world of embedded machine learning and the integration of all those LLM models, and looking forward to seeing what comes next.
Yeah, thank you.